Hi, welcome back. In this video lesson, we will deal with LGD, the loss given default, and its estimation. We will consider the different factors affecting the value of LGD and the way in which we can estimate it. And we will see different approaches to its estimation. Now, LGD is a very interesting topic that could represent the subject of one entire week. If you are really interested in all the small details involved in the computation, in the statistical estimation of LGD, my suggestion is to ask for it to be the extra topic of week 6. In this week, in this video lesson, and with the online materials that you can find on the course platform, we will consider the most important characteristics of LGD. The loss given default, we know, is the loss rate experienced on a credit exposure if the counterparty defaults. It can take any value between 0 and 100%, and it is computed in terms of recovery rate. LGD is equal to 1 minus double R. It may seem weird, but LGD is never known in advance, sometimes not even a default, if no secondary market for the defaulted exposure is present. Only when the whole recovery process is over, we can fully assess the actual LGD. Before Basel II, most banks used to assess LGD and PD jointly, computing the so-called expected loss rate. Now things have changed. A very, very interesting topic is the relationship between LGD and PD, that is to say, between what we expect to lose and the probability of a default. Now, most models that we will consider together assume the independence of these two quantities, LGD and PD. You can imagine that this is not really realistic, and obviously this accounts for what goes under the name of model risk. It's one of the possible features of model risk. We will see these in more details later on, when we consider the different models, and we will also discuss a little bit about the empirical findings related to the relationship. So, just be patient, and we will discover a lot of things together. When considering the factors affecting LGD, or recovery rate, is essentially the same. Remember the strict relationship between LGD and recovery rates. We can essentially group the different factors into four different groups. One is related to the characteristics of the exposure. One is related to the characteristics of the counterparty. Some factors are related to internal factors of the bank, while the last group is concerned with the external factors, the macroeconomic factors. If we consider the characteristics of the exposure, we ask questions like, is there any collateral? What is the degree of effectiveness? That is, how easily can the exposure be liquidated? What is the level of seniority and its priority level? Are there guarantees by third parties? As you can imagine, different answers to these questions lead to different recovered amounts. A collateral always guarantees a higher recovery rate. Talking about the characteristics of the counterparty, it is important to know the industry it belongs to, as this can influence the likelihood to find a buyer for the defaulted company and the price at which it is likely to be sold. Similarly, the legislation of the country of the counterparty may affect the duration of the recovery. Finally, an extremely leveraged counterparty is typically something we do not wish for. Our internal efficiency also plays a role.
especially the best practices and performances with out-of-court settlements. This is an example of internal factors. Finally, we have external factors, typically macro factors. Later on, we will see that the state of the economy clearly affects recovery rates and thus the LGD. We will also see that the business cycle influences the PD and other quantities and how it impacts on wrong way risk. Regarding interest rates, no need to say that their level clearly influences the present value of recoveries.
When we deal with the estimation of LGD or recovery rates, we can typically distinguish two main approaches: market LGD and workout LGD. Market LGD assumes that we have the prices of the defaulted exposures and with that we can use these prices as an estimate for the recovery rate. Naturally, you understand this information is not always available, and that's why we can use another approach, which is the so-called workout LGD.
In market LGD, prices of defaulted exposures are used to estimate the recovery rate. If a defaulted bond trades at 40 cents a euro, we can say that the market is estimating a 40% recovery rate and a 60% LGD. This naturally requires the existence of a secondary market. Data about this type of exposures and their recovery rates can clearly also be acquired from rating agencies. For example, we know that for bond issuers in the public utility sector, the average recovery rate is almost 70%, with a standard deviation of 22%. Market LGD also includes two special subtypes, emergence LGD and implicit market LGD. The first relies on the market value of the new financial instruments that a company may offer to lenders for its defaulted bonds, something like shares or very long-term bonds. The implicit market LGD approach makes use of spreads on performing bonds, often under the strong assumption that LGD and PD are independent. We will see, using Merton's model, that spreads on corporate bonds necessarily depend on the expected recovery rate. This fact allows us to make the necessary computations. Most banking loans are not traded. Hence, it is quite hard to find a secondary market. In this case, we can rely on the so-called workout LGD, which requires us to compile a historical database from which an estimate of the LGD can be derived. This database contains information about past defaulted exposures, recovered amounts, recovery legs, procedure, and so on. Data can then be segmented by type of exposure, type of counterparty, etc. On the course platform, you can find more details about actual computations. We have seen that different factors may affect recovery rates. Mortgages on residential real estate tend to have a higher recovery rate, close to 90% and more. For unsecured overdrafts, recovery rates are close to zero. We can say something interesting about the cross-section distribution of recovery rates.
In the picture, you see an example of empirical distribution of recovery rates for a medium European bank. Now, this U shape is quite characteristic, and the little statistician in us should suggest that a good candidate to fit this data could be the beta distribution. And this is exactly what many scholars have done in the empirical literature.
The density of a beta with parameters A and B and support on 0,1 is given by the formula on your screen. The parameters A and B can be easily estimated using the method of moments. let x bar be the sample mean and sigma squared the sample variance of historical recovery rates. We can easily get the estimates of A and B, as you can see on screen in the red formulas. This turns out to be rather useful in practice.
Thank you for your attention. See you next time. Unfortunately for me, I have still to correct some exams. That's part of the job. See you. Bye-bye.